This week on PTL, we face check the LCS semifinals, race through a regional roundup, and reveal the rookies of the split. Keep your hands and arms inside the vehicle. PrimeTime League starts right now.
He's going in, flash, bear, slap! Boudia is on the board!
The bomb that is Piglet is going off right now.
Best double kill ever. Ever.
I'm done. Like, I'm done. How do you top that?
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of PrimeTime League. I'm Riv and Jatt III, along with my compatriot, Joshua Jatt Leesman.
Yes, that is right, Riven. This week, the LCS heads into their semifinals, and the LMS starts up their quarterfinals. Meanwhile, the LCK and LPL both start the final week of their regular season, which means, in short, we have a lot of ground to cover. But before we get to that, we actually have a big announcement we must talk about.
So much to do, so much to see, and that announcement is both big and exciting. Earlier today, Riot announced the venues and dates for this year's Worlds, and we wanted to share them with you. First up, the group stages will kick off at Le Doc Pullman in Paris. Those will take place on October 1st through the 4th and October 8th through the 11th.
The quarterfinals will be held in London on October 15th through 18th as Professional League of Legends returns to the historic SSE Arena at Wembley. Then the four remaining teams will move on to the semifinals on October 24th and 25th at the Brussels Expo in Belgium.
That's right. That will all lead up to the finals where the top two teams in the world will battle for the title of 2015 League of Legends World Champion. And that will take place on October 31st at the Mercedes-Benz Arena in Berlin.
And it's really exciting to have Worlds in Europe again this year. Again this year, because season one was the first time it was
Absolutely.
There. Especially after experiencing the All-Star Game last year in Paris, because some of the fans in Europe are just incredible. So stay tuned to lolesports.com for ticket information, and then you can find out how to be part of that action.
I'm excited about that, because I did miss that action. Now, we're going to actually shift to some of the teams that we may see on that world stage later this year, and we'll jump right in with a look at one of the big upsets from the LCS playoffs. That happened when third-place CounterLogic Gaming took on sixth-place Team Liquid in a best of five.
Yeah, a rematch matchup from the summer split in 2014. CLG were pretty big favorites heading into that one as well. And early on, they try and take down Phoenix.
Things look good here, right? Yeah, they're going to get Phoenix, but there's the six, the hyperkinetic position reverser. A little bit of resistances for them. They will get the retribution kill, but Team Liquid used advantages great here.
Technically, they did kill Phoenix.
Yeah.
CLG needed to really snowball this early game. A lot of early pressure came out of Xsmithie's Lee Sin. You can see 2-1-5 early on in the game, kill participation-wise.
Yeah.
But Phoenix kept picking up kills. He was too hard to take down, and Team Liquid got enough gold to eventually withstand the split pushing and then find teamfight victories.
Yeah, Team Liquid really in the heads of CLG this game, especially with the Aphromoo Alistar pick here, first time of the split, using it nicely with Dominate, and they just cycle the crowd control in these fights perfectly.
Yeah, especially the Rumble ultimate, which comes in right now. It hits pretty much everyone on CLG. Piglet was late to that fight on Graves as well, but he arrived at just the right moment to clean up everyone right there. And once CLG lost the split push game with some sloppy dives from Link's Twisted Fate, this game one was over.
Yeah, game one was over. The extended fight led to Link here going down for the eventual ace, that inhibitor, and eventually the Nexus. And CLG was thinking of what to do to repair in game two.
Yeah, well, Pixajuani, bit of a team fight composition right here. Vladimir top lane, Tricky in the lane. They need to line their crowd control just right. So Sejuani and Nautilus had to lock down the Protect the Kog'Maw strategy on the other side. But if CLG uses their crowd control on a tank, as you see here, it might not work.
It also leaves the 5-1 Phoenix and 7-1-6 Kog'Maw. That Piglet, these two going off this game, and it just helped that Dominate was that big.
Yeah, St. Vicious did tweet later in this game, just run around like an idiot on Nunu, perfect initiation. And that actually worked for them right here. Piglet and Phoenix clean up, as you'd like to call it, full house, three kills over two kills.
That's right.
And it's the clean ace.
Cleaning it indeed. Team Liquid just seemed to have CounterLogic Gaming's number throughout these games. But game three, was that the one that CLG could pull it back in?
It's a situation CLG has been in before and did not respond well to. This time, all they had to do was stay alive and late. But they couldn't do that. Quas solo kill all the Zion Spartan. Phoenix on Vladimir also had his eyes set on Link.
So tough. And Team Liquid was not afraid to go hard, too. You see Phoenix messing up a bit, but he still feels confident about it. A quick flash out. He gets the kill. Kills across the lanes mean Liquid is that much farther ahead.
Team Liquid playing with lower expectations. You could see they're playing very free right there, whereas CLG was playing a little bit scared, trying to make up, trying not to fall too far behind. That's what happens with Aphemous Alistar walking in without his ultimate, and CLG gets destroyed in this fight.
Yeah, late little mistakes. Not even really late. 23 minutes was that Baron attempt, so we're mid-game, but TL's pushing it late.
And TL also has patience. Watch how long Dominate held that Sejuani ultimate right there, as well as Quas's ultimate on Hecarim to clean up that fight and the series.
That absolutely amazing stuff coming out of Team Liquid. What can does this actually mean for them?
Yeah, I mean, looking at that series holistically, CLG did buckle under the pressure eventually. Games 1 and 2, not so much, actually. I think Game 1 was very close and competitive. They couldn't finish the split push. They made a small mistake.
Right.
Game 2 was going to be snowbally either way. X-Smithy had to land a Sejuani ultimates, and he couldn't. But once it got around to that Game 3, you could tell CLG was just mentally destroyed. They died in solo lanes, which is something that did not happen during the regular season, so only under high pressure is that going to happen. And that means they have to wait until next year to try and get some meaningful championship points for Worlds.
What a crazy downward slope the CLG took after such an amazing start for rotations and their split. But now for Team Liquid, what does this mean for them moving on? Is it kind of like the Dominate in the beginning of the season tweeted, hey, you know, be careful, we played well, but it might not be everything, or do they still have work to do?
They have a lot of work to do because they face Cloud9 in the next round, who is the team that knocked them out of the playoffs two splits in a row already. And it's a time that they almost, it's a team they almost never beat. But it is the opposite of CLG's story. It's a team gaining momentum as the season progresses, which is really important for them. It's also Piglet, the first time he's actually looked good as a Team Liquid player. 25 kills in this series alone, 33 kills in four times the number of games during the regular season. If there is a time for them to come together, it is right now. And they have to be more confident after this series against CLG. Still a lot of work to do.
Well, it seems like the series has favored them. Piglet getting to buff his stats a little bit throughout that long gameplay. Yeah. And the pressure didn't seem to affect the team there. Team Liquid will move on to the semifinals this Saturday, where they face Cloud9, as Jatt said. And to shed more light on that matchup, let's send it over to Freak and Professor Kobe.
Thank you very much, Riv, and thank you, Professor Kobe, for joining me here.
Ah, you're welcome, Freak.
Ah, you're gracious. Much better than Zyrene. I want to catch with you more often. Anyway, guys, it's playoff time. Let's look at the semifinal matchup. Cloud9, Team Liquid. Cloud9 come in as huge favorites. If history repeats itself, C9 is an easy win. Lifetime, C9 is 18-1 against Team Liquid or Curse. They are 5-0 against the guys in the playoffs. I mean, on paper, it's one-sided, completely one-sided here.
That is a ridiculous record. Plus, everybody remembers the games this season. The first one was that game where Piglet forgot his masteries, and he also had to face Sneaky's Kalista. That turned out very poorly for him and the rest of Liquid. And then the second game was the game where Cloud9 fully embraced this tank meta. They had tanks everywhere, tanks in the support role, in the jungle role, in the top lane, everybody bringing point-and-click CC to lock down Piglet, to lock down Phoenix, and they just rolled over Team Liquid.
Yeah, and speaking of point-and-click CC, we got to see high on Lissandra for both games against Liquid overall. Mm-hmm. It's one of those like very few champions high actually seems to do well on.
Yeah, high is always a question mark when we're looking at these Cloud9 games. It's the Zed and Lissandra, very obvious, but then nobody really knows where he's going after that. You see some Jarvan, maybe some Corki. It's always a question mark. Whereas he's going to be facing Phoenix this time around, and Phoenix has really showed up in the playoffs. For me, this guy is the new cornerstone of Team Liquid. He's performed so well in the playoffs. Everybody talks about, oh yeah, he's so good in scrims, but he never really showed up in the LCS. He was a big, big playmaker for the team, and he works really well with Piglet. Plus, he's learned from Keen, and he's got that Urgot in his repertoire, which is always a good tool against Cloud9.
Yeah, sure, the Korean Urgot mid's doing pretty well. We've seen it's a great pick against Zed specifically, so a fun one to watch for. But I want to talk about his Korean teammate here on Team Liquid, Piglet. Because Piglet, much like Phoenix, but I think kind of to an extreme, had actually a horrible regular season. Piglet lost constantly with Team Liquid here. But in the playoffs against CLG, he gets 25 kills in three games compared to 33 kills for his like entire regular season here. A good series finally for Piglet. Feels like he's finally shown up here for Team Liquid, a good player now, and a real all-star. But he's up against the top AD carry in North America. There is no question in anyone's mind that Sneaky is the best right now in NA. Seven deathless games in 18 in the regular season. And it's not like he's just hiding. He's going up and taking kills. He'll flash into the enemy team. He'll dash forward. He does so much work.
Sneaky does it all.
Sneaky does everything. He is my AD carry superhero right now. He's an absolutely great player. And Piglet versus Sneaky is going to be a very fun matchup to watch.
Yeah, that's definitely something everybody is looking forward to. Basically, the story is, though, Team Liquid had a great playoff series.
Yeah.
So they're looking to continue that trend.
We'll see if they can beat C9 for the first time in playoff history. But now, going to send it back to Riv and Jatt to check out the European scene.
Thank you, gentlemen. And over in Europe, fifth place newcomers Unicorns of Love took on fourth place Gambit in the quarterfinals. Looking for that victory.
A couple things we were expecting coming into the series were a lot of kills, crazy team fights, and hopefully some even crazier champion picks.
Hopefully some crazier champion picks. These coaches we have always heard on social media, even in the interviews, going back and forth about how crazy the game could be. And it delivered a little bit. It started off in the top lane slow as Diamond and Cabochard did what they could. It took them a little, but they got Visit Chalk. Yeah.
Well, Diamond was delivering some kills on a silver platter here for Cabochard in the top lane. He picks himself up the first one, but this game was really all about how big the top lane Maokai got and how Diamond helped him out. This time, a 2v2 in the top lane, but Gambit has level advantages and everything goes right for them in this dive.
Yep, it doesn't look like it's going to work. It almost took too long, but nope. Kickus comes back a little too early. Yep. They're just outside range and they pick up everything they want. Even get a little bit of a roam from the team.
Yeah, Betsy was there in case anything actually went wrong, but it did not. And then it's just a return dive because at this point, Cabochard is becoming such a beast. And we don't even need to see the rest of this game because it was literally Cabochard in the middle of five people not dying. Game two.
Everything he could do. Game two brought out the Udyr. As you said, they should have picked the Udyr as Kickus on not Udyr. Bear slaps Pinoy, stops him down, starts off the game with a first blood. Yeah, it's feeling good.
Udyr does not do level two ganks. Definitely not Udyr you need for those things. But honestly, it was still a Gambit game to win. They had a gold lead, but they decide a 5v5 turret dive 17 minutes in with a minimal lead, and it goes wrong.
Yeah, it goes very wrong. Power of Evil picks up quite a bit here, having blue buff to boot to start the fight as well. Makes him the triple kill earner here. Another one to follow here at the end as well. And Leviathan, he shrugs it off, but he knows the ace hurts.
And if we look at these team compositions, Gambit had the tanky lower damage team comp, the exact same team comp they had in game one. But what you don't want to happen when you're running somewhat low damage without much burst is to have a tanky Udyr who can spam turtle stance, but more importantly, the Orianna pick up four kills for more powerful shields.
Just about 12 minutes in. Here they try to kill Power of Evil again, but I guess if he hadn't got four kills earlier and he was a level down, he might have actually died here.
Yeah, maybe they would have been able to finish him off. Power of Evil, so many of these fights they get out with slivers of health, but that's what happens when your team can spam Black Shield, Turtle Stance,
right,
and Command Protect throughout these fights. Cabochard tries to go back in, but it's still not enough to finish him off. Meanwhile, Udyr's chasing people down. The shields were too big. Time for game three.
That story wrote itself as we saw over and over, rinse and repeat. Now in a game three, we see the kills start off. Jinx Rocket coming from the side, and it was Gambit looking for a bear here, but Vizachachi had other things in mind. What an all.
Play of the series right there. Sion smacking wall and killing two people, and the Udyr pick again comes in. World of Tanks entered the European LCS right here. Kickus and Vizachachi were unstoppable.
So funny. I was loving everything coming out of social media for this one. Gambit, not so much. They were getting the runaround this game, and Unicorns of Love once again showing, like did against Team Solo Mid, they're great in the series.
Power of Evil's AP Kog'Maw draws a ban. Gambit trying desperately to avoid all of Unicorn of Love's picks, and guess what they get as their reward? Shaco.
Shaco indeed. I guess you have to pull out all the stops if you really want to take down a team like Gambit. Gambit trying to fight back here. Go for Vizachachi, but always slivers of health as they exit the fight.
So beautifully executed right here. Unicorns of Love has the Shaco split push, but they also have the Syndra to get picks. They have nice disengage. Ooh. And here, you can tell he'd been farming for a while because he nearly one-shots Pinoy.
Love how he leaves the clone, takes the lantern. That's going to be the death of Jinx on that play. And Unicorns of Love grab Diamond here, and it's pretty much all they need to solidify the win.
Mm-hmm. Completely containing Gambit within their own base. Shaco jumps in the back of the fight, instantly kills the AD carry. Even though Power of Evil did go down, Unicorns of Love moves on to the semifinals.
Power of Evil got hit instantly there, but Unicorns of Love moving on strong. We'll see what they can do. And for more about that series win from the Unicorns, let's bring in another mythical creature. How's it going, Chalks?
Good riff. Thank you, Mythical, as usual.
All right, so the first thing we have to talk about is Worlds. What do you think about today's announcement?
I am super stoked, of course, that we are going to Belgium, Brussels, the capital of my fair city, with Worlds. And, of course, we're also going to Paris, London, and ending right here in Berlin for the Worlds final. I'm so excited.
All right, I'm going to count on you to show me around all the cool tourist spots. So, looking back at the quarterfinals now, what was the secret to success for the Unicorns?
For the Unicorns of Love, the secret was cheese.
Well, like, all you have to do is just check their like, LOL Kings for, like, the stupid shit they're playing. Like, they're playing Frozen Heart first item, Varus top. Like, are we really scared of that? Like, sure, they can pull out something weird. Like, you check the rune pages, like, having a Azir top rune page. Like, I've played against Azir top before. So, like, whatever cheese they pull out, it better be some really good Gouda, because I don't think that anything they can pull out is really going to scare us.
Some really good Gouda, actually, we say in Dutch. But it was cheese, I would say. I mean, it was picks that we hadn't seen before. Kickers came out with the Udyr in Game 2 and the Shaco in Game 4. But I wouldn't go as far as calling it cheese, because it was just a strategy that he practiced before numerous times, and he came out with it at exactly the right time, is what the Unicorns of Love love to do. And I also have to give praise to their support player, Hillesang. They first picked Morgana 3 games out of the 4, and he was absolutely phenomenal on that. It was banned away from him in game 4, and then he had to go to his Thresh, which was also phenomenal. But the Unicorns of Love were completely on point with their adaptation in that best of 5, and it got them the game and to the semifinal.
Yeah, that it did. And this weekend, the Unicorns will face first place SK Gaming. Do they have a shot at taking down the number one team in Europe?
Well, the Unicorns of Love might just be crazy enough to take down SK Gaming. SK Gaming is, of course, very methodical. They have their Dragon Control. They have their 1-3-1. They want to get Forgiven with a CS up and get him ahead and control the game from there. The Unicorns of Love, they thrive on chaos. And I don't particularly know if there's a method to their madness in what they do. But I do think it might be enough to throw SK Gaming off. And something I'm really keeping my eye on as well is not a specific player, but the coaches. Sheepy from the Unicorns of Love versus Inner Flame from SK Gaming, because Gambit saw it. You can't prepare for Unicorns of Love and what they're going to pull out in terms of special picks. So it will be really interesting to see how the coaches, what they have planned, and how they're going to adapt.
All right, awesome stuff. Great, Shox. Thank you very much. Hang on, and we'll be back with you in just a minute. And another team that made their LCS playoff debut last weekend was up-and-coming H2K Gaming, who faced off against the Copenhagen Wolves, hoping to beat that late season surge, H2K Gaming.
Yeah, coach of the split, Prawley, as well, trying to prepare his team to not get upset by the number 6 seed. New tank meta, a lot of work that Prawley said he had to do. This time we get to see Sejuani versus Gragas.
Yep, Gragas, still a pretty tanky man himself. Things haven't changed there, just eating ultimates for breakfast.
Yeah, because seeing the main playmaker right there, ooh, getting the flash flay into the hook, which set up first blood.
A lot of good plays
for
there.
For Jinx.
We still see 8-6 here, 31 minutes in. Odoamne, Lulex, so big. Airwox is big too, but they eventually find a way to take the big man down.
I know, Freeze on Kog'Maw versus Sharnan on Jinx, but once Jinx gets that first kill and Ryu goes running with her, it is a whitewash fight there. H2K destroys Copenhagen Wolves right there. 31 minutes, they already had 4 dragons, so they had control.
Getting real excited on that one as we move into game 2. Copenhagen Wolves look to stop the bleeding here as Airwox would start off fast with a fancy flash here too.
Yeah, Copenhagen Wolves had a nice team composition this time, hoping to snowball the game early. Like you said, beautiful flash by Airwox there. Gets Soren going. Typical right here, Copenhagen Wolves, when they're winning, freezes ahead and they just try and push and win.
Bit of a lack of vision here, and Ryu starts to get very big. We haven't seen much Diana play, but he showed off in these games.
Yeah, this is where you started to think maybe Ryu would be a problem in this game. Him and Kasing here kind of double up. One underrated thing about Ryu's success right here is he went an attack speed build later on in the game. He had the Lulu speed up so he could get his auto attacks in. This one's all Ryu, though.
Oh, right there, just explodes.
Copenhagen Wolves had Baron. They were about to push and start taking meaningful advantages in that game. There was a 10,000 gold lead when Ryu did that. Such a big play, but it sets up this fight.
And you can see Copenhagen Wolves, without getting that Baron, go for Broker to Dragon and H2K. That's everything they wanted.
Yeah, and just keep your eyes on Ryu's Diana. He's so far away. Freeze is respecting it. How far away can he be? He's not even auto attack range for most of it.
Ooh, not
and he's
far
dead.
Enough.
He's just dead as soon as Ryu sets eyes on him. That is why the Diana pick dominated Freeze's Kalista.
Absolutely crazy. What would they do next? H2K now on a tear, and they would start off in the top lane. Does Copenhagen Wolves to try and come back for this one.
Yeah, really trying to shut down Maokai. They did not want a big tank to be able to jump on Kalista in this game, but H2K knew that devious plan, and they set up a great counter game.
This looks great. Copenhagen Wolves coming in. Odoamne is going to die, but there are just too many. Also, this follow-up from Lulex. So nice to get them clean right before getting too far into the turret.
Beautiful Sejalt, and because it's already a 2-0 series, once you fall down in that game three, it's tough. So hard to come back. Young Buck, last ditch effort. They actually find an okay fight.
If that wasn't going to go well for them, I don't think anything could have for the rest of the game.
Yeah, definitely. Hjarnen gets the double kill. No one takes down Sivir, and then Sivir can run you down, as well as having the Righteous Glory. H2K, 3-0.
Very big stuff for them, and we'll see what they can continue to do. Okay, so let's bring back Shox for some insight. Shox, this one was a little more straightforward, so break it down for us.
Yeah, it definitely was. The Copenhagen Wolves, definitely the underdogs coming into this quarterfinal versus H2K, and that's how it panned out as well. A clean 3-0 for H2K, and the only shimmer of hope, I should say, for the Copenhagen Wolves was at the beginning of Game 2, where they got a good advantage over H2K. It was the first time, or the second time, rather, in 14 games that H2K was down at 20 minutes. Usually, they make up a huge amount between 10 and 20 minutes, but they did prove that they could fight back from that and beat the Wolves even in that Game 2 when their Hecarim and their Kalista was fed. Another factor for me that was very decisive was Ryu on the side of H2K. Yamato Cannon, the ex-coach for MYM who was on the desk with us, said before the series that he counted Ryu to the top two mids in EU, not because of the flashy plays he made, but because of the things that usually go unnoticed. For instance, setting up his team for objectives all around the map by pushing up minion waves. But in this series, he was great. He went 23-6 and 24 over three games, and he proved that he can also make those individual plays on top of playing the map.
Yeah, it was really awesome to see some of his games kicking up some dust on Ahri, not a champion we've really seen in the past few weeks here in the NA LCS. So now, moving on, the second European LCS semifinal matchup this weekend is H2K versus Fnatic. What are you expecting here?
Whew, what a matchup that's going to be. H2K versus Fnatic, head-to-head the entire season already. I do think it's going to go to five games, and we're talking about two teams that excel in the mid-game, but in a different way. Fnatic, because they get those crisp team fights and push their advantage super hard after that, and H2K, because they are so methodical in the early game, setting up the dragons and pushing the towers. As an example, although Fnatic is 2-0. This split versus H2K, the last time they met at 20 minutes, they were quasi even in gold, even though Fnatic was up 5-0 in kills, because H2K had kept the control and pushed three towers to zero.
All right, Shox, and I also want to get your view on which players you will be keeping an eye on.
Well, it's got to be in the mid lane for me. I already touched on Ryu and the way he's also stepped up in their quarterfinal for H2K versus Febiven in that mid lane. Of course, there's history there. Febiven used to be on H2K when they qualified for the LCS and then chose to go with Fnatic. I asked Febiven about this in the past. He said, well, I don't really care who I'm playing against. I just want to win. But I do hope that they're both go for absolutely in-your-face champions and we see a brawl in that mid lane.
All right, Shox, and before I let you go, it is time to put you in the hot seat once more and get your predictions for this weekend.
Ah, Riv, it's so difficult. I think of out of the four teams, they all potentially have what it takes to go all the way. If we look at it semifinal by semifinal, Unicorns of Love versus SK Gaming, it must be the fact that these unicorns are so mythical, but I have an inkling that the Unicorns of Love can take it. In a straight-up game, a standard game, rather, I would give it to SK Gaming 9 games out of 10, but the Unicorns of Love and what they've shown in terms of versatility and adaptability in a best of 5, I would be scared if I was SK Gaming. So I'm going to give it to the Unicorns. And then the other one, H2K versus Fnatic, head-to-head all season already, and I think it's going to go 5 games, and H2K has shown some incredible play, but I think the way that Fnatic, if they get an advantage, they drive it home, will be decisive in this one, and I'm going to call it for Fnatic, but it's going to be close.
All right, thank you, Shox, and we will be watching to see how those predictions play out.
Cool.
In the meantime, let's head over to Jatt, who is ready to hand out another League Championship Series award.
Thanks, Riv. And last week, we gave the Coach of the Split Awards to TSM's Lokodoko and H2K's Prawly, and this week, we're going to present the trophies for the Rookies of the Split. First up, the award for the top European rookie. It is no surprise that this award goes to Fnatic's top laner, Huni. With his coordinated roams, his innate team fighting ability, and his sense of humor, Huni is the complete package for Fnatic. He has the third highest KDA for a top laner in Europe, but what's more impressive is that his GPM is the highest for a top laner across the entire LCS, as is his kill participation. Huni's involved in nearly 3 out of every 4 Fnatic kills, and also deals 27% of his team's damage to champions, which is the most for any top laner, again, in the entire LCS. And in honor of his victory, here is a special mini mic check, Huni edition.
I want to stop famous. I'm really famous, you know?
Huni, what are you going to say today to make yourself even more famous?
Oh no, I'm stop trolling. Really, I'm never more so trolling.
We can fight.
I love it.
Caitlyn!
Actually, if I carry all on, I go nyam 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 nyam.
I can use TP!
Stop screaming!
Huni, 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 Huni,
Huni,
Huni,
Huni, Huni, Huni. I'd actually like to welcome Huni to Primetime League now. Huni, congratulations on being named Rookie of the Split.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, honestly, I just have to ask you, now that you have it, how does it feel to be named Rookie of the Split for the European LCS?
Oh, I'm really happy for. I didn't expect anything, but so good. Yeah, I'm really happy though.
You did it. So happy. That's great. And honestly, this is your first real competitive experience here. What was the most difficult part of playing on this Fnatic team, this split?
Of course, first, I think communicate. I have to speak English, but I was really bad in half English, so I have to improve, and we have to more improve about communicate. So I think most hard point is English, I think.
Yeah, plenty of stuff to work on as well, Huni. Congratulations once again on Rookie of Split, and best of luck in the playoffs.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
See you later, Huni. Thank you. Now let's send it over to Freak, who has been soothing his PTL FO4 loss by turning to Twitter.
Chat, I have no idea what you're talking about. I got the most points PTL FO4. I'm the best, as always. Anyway, let's turn to Twitter. Last week, we asked you guys to get on and let us know which teams will win the European and North American LCS quarterfinal matches and how many total games will there be. Well, the correct answer was H2K, Team Liquid, Unicorns of Love, and Team Impulse with a total of 14 games. And to try for a chance at the Hall of Fame, you had to tell us how many total kills there would be, which was 423. Well, let's take a look at your tweets and see how many of you managed to get it right and find out who will be entering the Hall of Fame. Interesting. Guys, I made it a little bit harder on you and you do this to me? I get paid based on how many correct tweets there are. Right, whatever. So because all of you failed, we're going to give you guys another shot to redeem yourselves. Double or nothing. This week, tell us which teams will win the North American and European LCS semifinal matches and how many total games will be played. And for a chance to get into the Hall of Fame, you also have to tell us which team will win the LMS finals this weekend and how many total games will that be. I'm not sure if that's any easier, but you have to work for PTL Infamy 140 characters at a time. For example, if you ask me, and you should, I'm going with Fnatic, Cloud9, SK Gaming, and Team Solo Mid in a total of 16 games, and I'm picking the Yowie Flash Wolves to win the LMS in 3. So send your answers to us at LOL Esports, along with the hashtag PTL, and we will totally judge you guys again next week. Now we have something a little different for you guys on Primetime League. We're going to head off the Rift and meet with the man behind League of Legends' unofficial esports anthem, Silver Scrapes.
All right, so I'm going to play a little bit of the lead line here. Forgive me if I'm a little rusty. It's been about 3 years since I've opened up this project. My name is Danny McCarthy. League of Legends fans may know me as the composer for Silver Scrapes. I started composing music when I was 15 years old. I continue to do it every day and learn new things every day. I don't know, I'd say it took about maybe 10 years before I got any gig whatsoever. Killer Tracks, they hired me to write a song and you know, it was my first gig. I was, I think, 22, 23 years old or so. That Friday they gave me the gig, they said, hey, it's due on Monday. And so it was a crazy weekend, not much sleep. It was a success, so they went ahead and hired me for another song. Actually, Silver Scrapes itself was made in probably 4 days. I did have a deadline, a very strict deadline, but I didn't have any money, and I actually wrote Silver Scrapes on a 10-year-old laptop. I don't know if you want me to pull it up. The screen's cracked. The keyboard, there's some buttons that work, but most of them don't. USB ports over here will shock you if you plug in there. And this is what I created Silver Scrapes on. When I do production music, it's different than putting it out as an artist, because I write the music and then I put it out, and it can be anywhere. It can be on television, commercials, ads, all over the place. But nobody knows my name, nobody knows anything about who made the song or anything about it. And once I finish it, I don't know where it's going. In 2012, I believe Riot had some technical errors during Worlds, and Silver Scrapes ended up playing like on an hours long loop, and so it just kind of got ingrained into people's heads, which, you know, it was lucky for me. I had some friends that are League of Legends players, and they watched it and said, oh my god, dude, your song was just on League of Legends for like 2 hours. And then I went and looked on YouTube, and I had Silver Scrapes was up there for, you know, it had like 500,000 views. And I was like, what? This is crazy. I had no idea what, at that time, League of Legends was. So that's how I learned. Ever since that point, I've been able to sustain myself without a 9-to-5 job. And I'm doing what I love. Part of that reason is because of League of Legends and because of the fans of League of Legends, and for that, I'm eternally grateful for that. I think being a musician, I consider it to be similar to being a serious League of Legends player. It takes a lot of work, a lot of dedication, a lot of sacrifice. I've started playing League of Legends now, and you know, I'm not good at all, and I'm not gonna give out my summoner name because it's bad. I'm sticking with the bots for a long time. It's not about the things. It's not about the big boards and you need all this stuff. You don't. You just need a passion and a drive and love for what you're doing.
Forever, right here.
Ba-na-na.
Season 2.
It's the whole song. Like, you hear any little bit of it, you're like, yep, that's exactly what happened.
And you have to start moving your head up and down. Yeah. Always. All right, so now let's turn our attention back to the North American LCS, where fourth place Impulse took on fifth place Gravity in the quarterfinals. And nobody really knew what was going to go on in this game.
Yeah, Gravity's been such a wild card this entire year, as well as Impulse just improving week over week. But we didn't know, with the pressure on in the playoffs, whether they'd be able to bring that same level of play.
And Haunter trying to get some kills for himself in the early game, but he gets the treatment, and one thing that Impulse has done all year is work very well with small leads.
Talked about that play a lot from Haunter. Just a bad idea. Yeah. The 1v1 was questionable, and he had no idea about the counter gank, and then once that happened, boy, did Impact and Rush punish.
Yep, just getting the through and through, bumped by Impact, onslaught of Slaughters backwards into more fight from Rush, and they just had their way with him.
Yeah, I mean, Gravity even said beforehand, the last times they played, the top lane jungle synergy from Impulse crushed them. And here, this game was getting ridiculously out of hand. Gravity did find a pretty good fight, nearly taking it with that shockwave.
Yep, very nice shockwave to start this one off. To the back line is Impact, however, and he was just too much for Gravity to control in this one. Adrian being huge, if he couldn't get the Leona, he actually threw to the Nautilus this game. It worked out for the team.
That is a 7,000 gold lead punching you in the face right there. No matter how well you're prepared, you can't handle it. Game two, though, they try and counter Rush's aggression.
Yeah, a little bit of a back and forth here. Impact picking that one up brings out top lane Morgana again as Keen picks himself up a kill. Double buffs as well.
The double buffs were incredibly critical. Keen got really strong in this game.
Yes.
We learned afterwards that Xiaowei Xiao forgot masteries in this game, 0-0-0. But Keen didn't care about that because he was fed on Fizz.
He was fed on Fizz, very much so. The Rumble ulti goes down, starts cooking the entire team. Nicely plays from Haunzer. He doesn't let that first game get to him. And Gravity starts to pull out strong that game too.
Yeah, they definitely had some nice pocket picks there with the Fizz mid, not something anyone else plays, and you could tell it kind of threw Impulse for a loop. Rush as well was countered very well by Saint Vicious.
Yeah.
Having the Rek'Sai vision of where Rush would be in the jungle without wards, and here you can just see a nice fight they fight.
This fight was pretty much ahead towards Baron, but Gravity caught Rush as you saw on the other side of the wall and really got the scattered skirmish in their favor. Something Gravity has kind of been back and forth with, but when they have the lead, seem pretty dominant.
Very good in team fights. That's Gravity's biggest strength, it feels like, as a team, able to take the Baron after this one and ultimately the game.
Pushing that to a game four, one of the longer series we had in the North American LCS, and it started off real early.
Yeah, ships in the middle of the day, running into each other right here, and a big bloodbath early on. Xiaowei Xiao gets that first blood on Zed, buys a longsword at the start of the game, and he never looked back.
Said in the beginning of this one too, as we were casting it, Xiaowei Xiao was at MVP. Where's that MVP been? And throughout this game, he came out. Leona for Adrian once again, and they were trying to make plays as Gravity fought back.
And this is something about this Impulse team, though. They seem to take all these fights that don't look like good ideas because they aren't, but then they go and make it work. They collapse later on in the fight. Xiaowei Xiao is 7-0, 13 and a half minutes into the game. Yes, that is a word.
Good old Xiaowei Xiao. Cop here just on the outside of dying.
Oh, God.
And then he gets pulled in by Xiaowei Xiao, the loving embrace of Xiaowei Xiao.
Deathmark does damage? I don't need Deathmark to proc.
For a second
it's actually
there.
A move block.
It's all right. So looking back at that series, what went right for Impulse?
Yeah, well, honestly, early on in the series, they were able to enforce a very early game style of play. They banned away Saint Fishes as tank junglers, and that was effective for them. But then once they adapted with Fizz to have the strong laning, they picked the Rek'Sai for themselves, Impulse kind of stopped caring about the tanks, Rush just built tank items on his fighter junglers, and they recreated that very fast and aggressive style of play. Rush is the man right here. His jungle has been so impressive throughout the entire later half of the season as he's been working up here. The fact that they also banned Fizz later in the series to adjust and allow Xiaowei Xiao to play Zed into something that he'd be able to kill. Enforced the fact that Impulse had a superior laning skill level on Gravity. In all of those games, they had higher CS numbers in the laning phase at 10 minutes over Gravity, which just allowed Rush to work with the lead and ultimately allowed Impulse to take that series.
All right, and Impulse advances to the semifinals and will face Team Solomid on Sunday. And to take a closer look, let's send it back to the professor and the protester.
Thank you very much, Riv. Let's talk about one more semifinal match in the North American LCS. Team Solomid versus Team Impulse. These guys, on paper, a whole lot closer. 1-1 in the regular season. First time these two teams met, week three. Rush didn't get off the ground. Santorum pooped all over him. The early game Lee Sin didn't do much of anything. And it was a pretty easy win for TSM.
That is true. But in week six, it was a completely different story. Rush did the pooping. He was back on Lee Sin, got that early aggression off the ground, getting his team ahead. And Morgana in the top lane from Impact was huge for them.
Yeah.
2-1-16, game-winning bindings. Really big turnaround for Team Impulse.
Yeah, and Xiaowei Xiao had a great game as well on Kassadin and almost single-handedly carried the team fights themselves if Impact did the other heavy lifting. But Team Impulse, honestly, as a team, they're a little bit of a win lane, win game team. So we wanted to actually break down all the lanes and talk about who we think has the edge in all these. Top lane matchup, TSM Dyrus, TIP Impact.
All right, this one, I think that we're going to have to give it to Impact just because of the way that TSM play with Dyrus in the top lane, leaving him on that island. Whereas Impulse, they like to feed into Impact. They want to get him top lane carry.
Yeah, and honestly, it's a very big check mark. Keep in mind the size. It actually does matter when we talk about this kind of stuff. Let's move to the jungle matchup, though. Santorin and Rush, both very, very good players.
Ah, this one is really close because Rush, he can single-handedly win you a game with some of these aggressive moves. However, Santorin is so consistent. Plus, Santorin has embraced the Cinder Hulk jungler, so I think this one's going to be a tie. We're going to give a different icon here over, though, because Santorin, the specialty right now is that Cinder Hulk so strong. This is going to be on 5.6.
Yeah, hey, man, Cinder Hulk Vi from Rush, maybe he'll have some good impact there on that one either way. Anyway, mid lane matchup, TSM, it's Bjergsen. I mean, what else are you going to say?
Yeah, I think that we do have to give it to Bjergsen, even though Xiao Xiao has been a bit of a wild card and shown up and had some really strong performances. Bjergsen, it's really hard to outdo the playmaking potential that he has and the amount of pressure that he brings to a game.
Yeah, true. So Xiao Wei Xiao, maybe playoff Xiao Wei Xiao is pretty good, but the last season MVP, not quite as strong this season, it seems so far. Either way, let's move on to the next matchup here. TSM, they got Wild Turtle and AD Carry. You've got Apollo over there for TIP. And I actually think both these players are very good.
This one, now this one is actually closer than a lot of people will think it'll be because Apollo gives Team Impulse just what they need. He plays the Graves. He's got that burst follow-up. He can play very aggressively. Or he's got the Sliver. He can speed up the whole team so they can dive more often. Mm-hmm. But Wild Turtle, I really like the improvements he's made this season compared to last season. And yes, he sometimes still goes over the line and goes a little bit too deep, but I like where his head's at, and I like an AD carry that can actually make some game-changing plays, whereas not a lot of other North American AD carries are willing to do that.
Yeah, I think the most similar AD carry for Wild Turtle is Uzi. He's obviously not as good as Uzi, because who is?
Crazy.
Yeah, but he's a little bit crazy, but it's really smart crazy, and I really like how Wild Turtle's playing this season overall. Apollo, he's consistent, but he's only playing these teamfight supporters, decent laners, but you're going to get exactly what you put into him.
Wait till you see the Varus come out.
Yeah, okay, maybe that'll be a little bit worse. Overall, though, small edge to Wild Turtle, definitely great playmaking. Support role now, TSM Lustboy, TIP, Adrian.
I think this is another one that's a little bit more clear because while Adrian is like Apollo and gives Impulse a lot of what they need with the long range engage, very offensive guy, he's going to follow up on anything or even initiate for your team. Mm-hmm. Lustboy, his mastery of not only the Annie, but also defensive support mastery, which is huge in this matchup particularly. Yeah. The Janna could be huge for them. Also, vision control. He can keep Rush in check, try and help Santorin keep track of him.
I absolutely agree with you here, Kobe. They're both very good players, but I'd rather have Lustboy on my team because he can play hard engage or defensively, and that gives a huge edge in a BO5 where adaptation is huge. Adrian, look, he's good on Annie, he's really good on Leona, but you're gonna be seeing a hard engage bot lane every time from TIP. You can see a lot of things from TSM.
Yeah. There is one little caveat, though. Even though I did give that Cinder Hulk icon over to Santorin, there's an interesting change with the TP Smite coming in. Because Team Impulse are so top lane oriented, they could just have Impact build a Cinder Hulk. Rush doesn't have to build a Cinder Hulk. He can play an early aggressive jungler like the Lee Sin, like he likes to play. Just get Impact ahead, and then boom, there's your super tank. You've got a Cinder Hulk jungler on your team. Just happens to have teleport and come from the top lane.
Well, hey, if Dara's going to get no Genghis, since give him a Cinder Hulk, have him go jungle, and he can go ahead and hide away from everyone else.
Cinder Hulk's for everybody.
Cinder Hulk's for everybody. So overall, Kobe, it's going to be a very good matchup. I'm going to say at least 4 games this one. Who are you giving the edge to?
I think it'll be really exciting, that's for sure. But slight edge to TSM.
Yeah, all right, slight edge to TSM. I kind of agree with you here in this one. It's going to be fun overall to watch. And if you guys want to join other LCS fans to watch semifinals or the finals themselves, check out one of the upcoming viewing parties happening this weekend around the country, including New York and Georgia.
And to find out more or learn how you can host a viewing party of your own, head over to lolesports.com/VP, where you can find all of the details.
It's going to be a whole bunch of fun, but now let's send it over to Riv, who has another LCS award to hand out.
Thanks, guys. And now it's time to name the North American Rookie of the Split. This jungler joined one of the most popular LCS teams this spring and has done an amazing job adjusting to the pressure of the big stage. And we are happy to present the North American Rookie of the Split Award to Santorin. TSM's rookie jungler has the highest KDA for the role across the LCS, which has led him to a 75% kill participation. And when he's not busy making plays with his teammates, he has proven he's still a good sport by helping us out by playing Lee Sin on PrimeTime League. Now, I'd like to welcome Santorin to PTL. Thank you for joining us. And without the blindfold this time, I have to say congratulations on winning the award. I'd like to present you with the Rookie of the Split Award. I have a few questions for you as well before I let you go and obviously bring that around the city and show everyone.
Yeah, I will.
Coming into the split, there was kind of a stigma that you would be playing a follow the leader, that you would kind of be in the shadow of Bjergsen, and you wouldn't be able to do much for the team kind of behind his carry. How did you overcome that? Because you had an amazing split.
So in the start of the split, we're mainly just focused around Bjerg because we didn't have that much time going into the split. So we're just like playing towards Bjergsen, but eventually we feel like we can like put me into a bigger carry role because like, okay, we know Bjergsen can carry, but we also have to have another guy who can carry. And then it just became easier and easier because I was a carry jungler beforehand, so it was not that hard for me to pick it up again.
All right. And with you guys being so strong right now, obviously doing so well at IEM, in your thoughts, how is TSM looking on the big stage this year?
I feel like we're looking pretty good at the big stage. I feel like I would say we're the best team in North America right now. Also, we still have something to improve on, but it's not like big issues that cannot be like... We can easily fix them, so I feel like we're going to be really good on the big stage.
All right, man. Congratulations to Team Solomid on all the wins. Congratulations on the Rookie of the Split Award as well, and best of luck as you guys continue. Thanks. Now, let's head over to Freak and Zyrene for a quick look at our two newest LCS teams.
Thank you very much, Riv. And as we turn from Santorin's Rookie of the Split Award to teams that won their way into the LCS Summer Split, happy to be joined by the man with the sweet dance moves, Aiden Zyrene Moon. How you doing?
I'm doing all right, man. Not dancing today, so it's time for serious mode.
Time for serious mode, guys. In the North American Challenger Series, serious things happened. Heavily favored enemy esports took on TDK in the finals with a spot on the North American LCS on the line.
Yeah, and this was a really hyped up match. Enemy came into it as heavy favorites, and you could see right off the bat that they were exerting their dominance. That level 6 power spike in the top lane for Flares immediately presses it into a solo 1v1. See the backup coming in there, but off on the side, Trashy comes in to help clean up that kill and give first blood to their top laner.
Yeah, thankfully for both teams, support came in partway through, so no more kills came through, but it was a very good start for this Flares Hecarim. Teamfight comp, oh god, they're at Dragon.
Yep, that great flash triggers there from Body Drop just started that fight off perfectly, and the Ludens Echo power spike for Katarina came in, and they immediately wanted to fight with Inox, picking up so many kills and snowballing the game.
Yeah, 5-0, get a Baron, win the game. Okay, switch sides, TDK, they've got the teamfight comp, they got some hard engage, and oh god, things are bad for enemy esports.
Oh yeah, they're bad, because Seraph is TP Smite, top lane Gnar, and he starts wrecking this game, taking it over with the fact that nobody can duel him.
And he just destroys everybody. One more team fight. Let's try again. Another good start of the battle for TDK, and it gets better and better as time goes on.
Contesting that dragon, they have the poke comp, but Inox doesn't land any spears. And this fight is so long and drawn out that by the time they get halfway through it, you would expect Kyle had used his ultimate by now. And Otter did too, because he walks up, and Kyle immediately capitalizes on that, getting Luigi G a triple kill.
Yeah, a couple of javelins in the backside. Inox does what he can, but just simply the poke comps were not working in this series. It's going to be the game 2 victory to TDK to tie up that series. But here we go, game 4. Match point for enemy esports. A desperate Baron for TDK.
We can see TDK are in the lead, and they have the threat of a fifth dragon. But right there, that ultimate from Body Drop onto Kyle. No reaction time for him to use his ultimate or Zhonya's. And that was the turning point in this match.
Inox on Kassadin, the only player I've seen play it so far in this patch, but absolutely crushing with it. Finally, Otter able to kite back the Shyvana as well. Here's the final ace, and that was the game that sent enemy esports into the North American LCS. That was the team fight. Very, very exciting series overall, but a big congratulations to a bunch of excellent players in enemy esports.
And you could see right there how happy they were because of that, because it was such a tight game. Otter was getting soloed by Seraph over and over and over again in the team fights, and Seraph really put up a huge fight, so I'm excited to see how TDK does in the promo tournament.
That's true. We are still going to see a lot of those teams overall. Now, of course, in the European Challenger Series, we had XPK's Origin face off against Copenhagen Wolves Academy to find out who would join the LCS over in Europe.
Yeah, this was a matchup, once again, heavy favorites for Origin coming into this. All their lanes seem really strong, and that's why we go immediately into game 2, because game 1 was just a crushing victory for Origin.
Yeah, you can see Kirei, you know, trying to put his carry pants on for these guys, but honestly, Origin already with a gold lead and a pretty good team fight here.
It's 14 minutes in, and it's already a 5-on-5 in the Dragon Pit. And Niels, this guy coming out of nowhere, Danish as well, getting himself a triple kill. It's not even going to protect the Kog'Maw, and he runs away with this game.
6,000 gold lead at 11.5 minutes. Origin already crushing in game 3. We get to see Soaz 1v1 against Morsu, even though he's down a level here.
Yeah, Soaz played Maokai all 3 games, really wanted to win this series. Morsu's the guy who brought out the Fiora, brought out the top lane Yasuo to try and carry this game. But that sapling right there, the presence of mind from Soaz to set that up ahead of time, is absolutely amazing. Gets in the solo kill.
Knocks him down, 10-2 the scoreline here. You know, let's watch Peke. He's pretty good too. He's playing Zed. He's going to go blow up Morsu some more.
He's 11-2-4 at this point. And you don't even get the death mark indicator there. It looked like he was going to be scot-free. But Peke doing Peke things this game, going off on Zed.
And speaking of doing Peke things, how about a Nexus backdoor? I mean, he's got minions, so it's not really a backdoor, but you know, that's going to go down.
He is the sole champion damage dealer to the Nexus, so it still counts as a solo kill.
Solo kill for Peke. Looks like all is right with the world. Of course, these guys back in the European LCS here, Peke and Soaz, and joined by some more fun faces as well. Anyway, these two teams will join the LCS and compete in the summer split. Aiden, what do you think the chances are?
I think both teams are going to sit around fifth, fourth place. I think they will both make playoffs next season. I do definitely think that they are improvements over the current 10th place teams that they're replacing. I think the leagues are going to get more competitive because of these two teams entering.
Well, we still got some more spring split playoffs, but summer split definitely going to be fun to watch. It's going to be a whole bunch awesome, and we will help them prepare for the transition as you listen in on their future competition.
That's right, and I've always wanted to say this. It's time for mic check.
Got these boys?
Yeah, let's focus. Let's do it, boys.
Let's correct them.
It's the playoffs, baby.
Maybe we fell short at the very end, right? But it doesn't take away from our hard work and the fact that you guys played a hell of a season.
Nice, nice. Good job, guys.
100% Urgot win it.
Yeah, they ban Urgot next game.
Yeah.
Look at their face when we ban Urgot.
Why?
Because I want to see if they're surprised or something, you know?
Oh, no. Oh my god, it happened.
Sorry, it's fine. It's only 50 gold.
See, when you say that, it's worse.
And you know, 100 for the item. I don't know how to say.
For item. Okay, this cap? That's cap.
Rababon, this cap.
Rababon's cap.
That's cap. Rababon.
Rababon.
They're gonna get Tatra after this win.
Lantern. Oh, ho.
Oh, our double thumbs up, Sam.
That was scary.
I got snared.
Okay.
I saw that.
Okay.
Oh, fuck.
Nice. Guys, we got a first goal. I love you! I really love you.
I'm gonna try to jank you.
Oh my
ward,
god, why are you here?
It's up to me. You're good, Cut.
Help me.
Baron.
You got this, Cut. You got this.
Baron.
Cut, I got you.
It's your Baron. Baron.
It's Baron.
W.
Alright, you just need to get the hell out of there.
No! I'm blocking!
Run, Cup!
Yo, turn!
No.
Cup, turn!
He'll never kill him.
No, I'm running.
Oh my god, are you joking?
Get him!
We got this, boys, just reset. Even if we lose, we still can win.
No, of course.
Don't give up, don't.
Every game is a new game. Yeah. It's just the best of five series.
Okay, nice. I'm actually coming as well.
I got it!
Got
nice!
Do you have shield?
Rabadoodles, whatever, it doesn't matter anymore. Either way, Kobe is here. He has lane swapped for Zyrene as we turn our attention to China's LPL as the teams head into the final week of their spring split with two playoff spots still to be decided. Now, one of those squads who will be in the playoffs was hoping to bust into the second seed as they face Master 3.
Yes, and that team is Snake.
Now, the guy we're going to talk about in game one, top laner Flandre. Everyone's looking at him all the time. This one, Master 3, go for a three-man gank onto him.
Yeah, Flandre is the target really early on. He's able to dodge some of the skill shots here. There's three people though, and not unless it's a wall, he's gonna close that distance anyway. So first blood on Flandre. Oh no, whatever will we do, Freak?
Get angry, go back after him.
Part deux, Flandre's revenge. He's coming straight for Dade. And this time, Flandre is the one with backup. Gonna take down Xerath in the mid lane.
You bring three, I bring four. Requiem helps a little bit as well. But guys, let's watch more Flandre. This time, Homeguard teleport.
Now this is his mastery over the team fight scenario. Homeguard's in, gets a great pillar, then backs off and zones while not taking damage, waiting for the re-engage opportunity. Another pillar, gonna pick up some extra kills.
Baka narrowly escapes death twice there from Nautilus, and then, you know, Crystal keeps getting Draven for some reason.
And he keeps cashing in.
Yeah, it's pretty good. All right, game two. Who gets revenge this time? Dade. Dade gets revenge. Goes after Baka.
Yes, Flandre, you can take over a game. Dade's turn. He's going to go straight at Baka on his signature champion, taking the LeBlanc into the Xerath.
All right, well, you know what? Let's do it again. Let's do it again. This time, instead of support helping me, Dade, let's go for it again.
Nice sidestep there. Good hook here. Support comes in to help and secure that kill just to make sure.
All right, more just for Dade. So far, a lot of 2-on-1 kills on Xerath. Let's do it again. This time, Looper will do it for him.
Looper comes in from the back. Easy setup right there. Time for Dade to take things into his own hands, though.
Finally, it's a one-on-one kill. Okay, that was quick.
It's pretty late in the game, and he's kind of fed, but hey, made it work.
The revenge comes in, a 1-1 series overall. Now, guys, the LPL begins the final week of their spring split tonight, so let's check out the standings. In first place, where they have been since week four, are Edward Gaming, and now followed by Team Snake.
Meanwhile, OMG, Vici, Invictus, and LGD have all qualified for playoff positions, with two more spots that will be decided over the next few days.
Yeah, so good stuff there. But just like the LPL, Korea's LCK are in their final spring split week as well. And even though both of these teams have qualified for the playoffs, hooks flew as third place CJ Entis took on fourth place Jin Air Green Wings.
Ah, yes. Mad Life in his element here. Even trying out the newer hook support, Nautilus.
And this has been great to watch overall. So this one, not too hard. Point blank ulti, hits Captain Jack, but pulls him back into the equalizer.
Yeah, look at him manhandle this AD carry. Captain Jack didn't get to do anything there. And once again, we see Nautilus plus Rumble. Really strong combination here, to say the least.
I love this one. He actually knocks up both people in the back line right on top of equalizer.
Yep, that's going to take out all of the threat there from Jin Air. And CJ giving Jin Air a lot of extra air time this game.
You think they'd be better at that with all the wings they've got, but either way, Dragon Fight now, CJ. All right, here we go, Madlick. Oh, no, he missed the hook.
Oh, my goodness. Whatever will we do? Oh, wait, we have backup here. Coco going straight in on the Cho'Gath knockups of his own and the Zhonya's to survive.
And Shy absolutely destroying everybody, chasing people around the map, making life miserable. CJ's frontline does nicely, and Chaser becomes a Chasee as he leaves the team fight.
Run away, and he's safe under the secondary turret.
All right, good job. All right, game two, you take my Nautilus. How about Blitzcrank?
Yeah, bring him into the top lane here, will you? Mad Life back on the classic hook champion, and Trace, you have nowhere to go.
No, he's gone. Here we go, 1-0. Good start for CJ Entis. Mad Life, he could kill enemy champions. He can kill,
yoink,
jungle monster.
Gonna grab that one and wait around for the last hit. More cooldowns means more hooks from Mad Life.
Great, here's one, bam.
And this one's going to be on Chaser. Not only does he kill the jungle camps, but he kills your jungler as well.
Take one from every single person on the team. All right, one more time. Here we go with a Baron fight. This one's going to be pretty risky. Xerath, he's hitting your Baron. What are you going to do, Madlife?
3,000 HP left on that Baron. I better wait around here in the Xerath ultimate. What are you doing? You can't stand still in front of Madlife. You're making it too easy for him.
Well, I mean, but Madlife's known for, you know, predicting movements. You know, the Madlife was predicting a flash, looking away from the guy. Uh-huh. He was just trying to play mind games.
Yeah, well, stand still. Madlife confirmed, not a Tyrannosaurus Rex. Doesn't work.
All right, no dinosaurs left in this game. Either way, it was a pretty good one. Now, with just three series remaining, here's a look at the LCK standings. The GE Tigers rule first place, followed by Faker and SK Telecom T1 in second. And if you want to see those two teams clash in their final games of the split, tune in this Saturday at 1 a.m. Pacific to see who walks away with the Korean bragging rights.
CJ Entis and Jin Air round out the other two playoff-bound teams, and they are actually going to face each other in round one, which starts on April 17th. The winner is going to take on SKT in round two 1 week later on April 24th.
And while the LCK and LPL still have that 1 week left in their spring split, the LMS will be kicking off their spring playoffs tomorrow when Hong Kong Esports takes on HQ Esports Club in round one.
Yeah, the winner of that match will take on the Taipei Assassins in round two on Saturday, and the winner of that series will advance to take on the heavy favorites and number one seed, Yowie Flash Wolves, on Sunday the 12th.
Should be some good games. And as the teams throw everything against the wall to see what sticks in hopes of making the playoffs or winning it all, we've seen some pretty amazing moments ourselves.
Yes, that means that coming up with just five plays is a rather Herculean task, but somebody's got to do it. So here are the plays that went above and beyond, or as Uter now calls it, definitely not the Penta. Coming in at number five, Kaboom Black left us breathless with their Wombo combo.
E olha isso agora, foram pra cima do Matsukaze, que já saiu com o seu flash. Chega o Skybite, foi pra Mega Nar. No momento certo, o Goku já é. Aliás, consegue o seu killing spree. Certo, o Libek tem tentado. Lindo combo, alucinante novamente. Três abates pro time da Kaboom. Nossa senhora, Pepo, quanto controle de grupo. E a Kaboom.
And rolling in at number four, LGD shocked us with their ball delivery combo.
And MLXG as well. He can auto-attack during most of that one. The knockup's not going to be there for too long. As you can see, there they are all coming through. And Imb is just getting bounced around. But you can see he doesn't take too much damage. That shockwave was godlike onto four members. Imb is somehow still alive. Picks up a triple kill as well. One for five. And LGD make it look easy.
And LGD have finally shown the world the Kog'Maw ball carrier comp, as everyone was on top of Kog'Maw, all the melee champions gap closing on top of him for the picture perfect equalizer.
At number three, Phoenix was out for blood in his duel with Link.
They have kind of this early game down, how to stop it, how to get the kills that they want. Really playing well from both sides. Hemo play goes down, a few more transfusions. That should be a dead Link. The blue buff going over to Phoenix. He flashes out and he gets the play as he turns around for the no look.
At number two, Mystic mystified us with his quadra kill on Jinx.
Drizzle just gets destroyed there with all that damage. Amazing J is coming around the side there. You can see a good ulti hits him, but Mystic gonna pop in. Now Amazing J gonna try and move through. Massive damage onto Mystic, but they peel beautifully for him. Amazing J will go down. Shoe Force to back off there as well. We'll get popped by the Cork, and the missile gonna get the third. There's the triple coming in for Jinx. Raphael now has to be careful, gonna go down. That'll be the Quadra coming through for Jinx.
And charging in at number one, Visichachi's Sion was unstoppable as he picked up the instant double kill.
That's a flash forward. Betsy has found kickers. There's no smite. Visichachi's not ready. He gets a double kicker with the unstoppable Roar of the Slayer.
Best double kill ever. Ever. Let's look at Chachi flying in.
Is it through the wall as well? It is too.
It is. He smacks the wall and then the AoE.
Oh! I'm done. Like, I'm done. How do you top that?
Oh!
Three kills. Triple kill Sion ult would be the only way to top that at that point. And then maybe four. Anyway, remember to send us the plays that bend your mind to at LOL Esports along with the hashtag ThePenta if you want to see them show up.
That's right. Penta. And with that, we can turn off the lights and sweep up after yet another episode of Primetime League.
Well, just a second, Riv. Last week we did have a newcomer on PTL. And as it turns out, his moves were out of this dimension. Thankfully, JDude700 was able to venture beyond time and space and captured this on video. So let's check it out in our last hit.
What is love? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more. Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more.
Oh my god. Oh, really, thank you. Really, 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 really thank you. Oh my god. Thank you.